Rosie waves on the moon.
Also.
Also. Lord, you're the living message. You are. You are the living word. And I'm in awe of you. And Lord, I surrender and yield every place. I don't want human wisdom to come out of these lips. I'm yielding every place in my life to a holy God. Holy, holy, holy God. Holy God, Lord, when you're here, what could I say except what you show me to say and what you reveal that you want to do? You've already moved among us. Lord, you've killed so many things in me that needed to die. And it was good. Because I'm finally happy in here. Lord, have your way here. You are so beautiful. I just want to keep singing to you, Lord. I just want to keep praising you. The message that I want to release is a message that you are a good, good Father, a loving Father. All through worship as we're singing, I just feel him so strongly, and the place that we were in of his presence, I want us to stay there. I want us to stay in that place and not kind of, he's so good. You know, many people have felt like they're in dire straits. And my new admin used to be in the Navy, and she likes to teach me lots of things that I never thought I wanted to know. Wonderful. Hey, I'm sure I'm teaching her lots of things she never knew she wanted to know. I was just saying, it was a little over a week ago. Actually, it was a week ago. I had a meltdown. And it wasn't like a bad meltdown like last year. Hey, you know what? Transparency is the only thing that's going to set people free in the body. And many of you don't know, but my husband and I almost didn't make it through last year, but the grace of God, my friend Donna, and my advisors, Carter and Diana, who really helped us. The enemy came in like a flood. And my heart was so shattered by the circumstances my husband got himself into. I didn't know if it was going to heal. And I didn't know my heart could be that broken ever again, because I'd already come out of brokenness. The Lord had healed me. And I honestly didn't know if I was going to make it. But I learned how good of a Father he is. And I love him so much. And he gave me the gift of compassion out of that breaking out of this. And he's healed our marriage. Set my husband free. He's got us on this amazing fast track acceleration. I have the marriage I always dreamed of, but had totally laid at the altar and never thought I would have. And I haven't. It's happening. God is doing it. It's a supernatural, miraculous work. But it's been hard, and because of different choices, then there's things that affect. And last week I was just having a rough time. I was just like, Lord, I know you asked us to do some things, but I just don't know if there's anything, I know there's nothing left in me, is what I told him. I said, I can't do what you're asking me to do, but you can. And it was that place of feeling like you were in dire straits. And she shared with me, he shared with me that dire straits, and I went and I looked it up on, I Googled it. You know, I like ask.com. I ask all kinds of questions. What does this mean? Why is this? In fact, today I was Googling things just because I like to know why certain things do certain things. But when she told me, she was talking about how it's such a dangerous place in navigating, like you probably know this because you sail. I don't know this. I don't sail. I go on the boat when Donna is sailing and I sit there and enjoy it and do something if they tell me to. Otherwise, I just sit there and mind my own business and enjoy the waves and the ocean. But dire straits is a place where two points of land meet and it creates a restriction of flow. And it's an incredibly turbulent and chaotic place. To the one who's navigating it, it can also present such an opportunity to be propelled forward. If you catch it, like catch the flow, like catch the wave, the swell, it can actually be a place that can propel you forward. And so I know many of us have been going through difficult things, circumstances, family stuff, and just all kinds of things that it's like, why, Lord, why? Why? And when I was going through what I was going through, I tried not to ask the question, why? But I tried to ask the question, Lord, help me to know who you're going to be and what you want me to do. And last week, when I was in this place of saying, I don't know, Lord, that I can handle any more of these places. I just, I believe you, God. And I would have been unpacking because we moved. And it was all the transition that brought me to this place. You see, we had crisis last year. We've had crisis for about 5 years. One after another. And I'm not talking little things, I'm talking big things. And through most of them, I was Pollyanna. Through most of it, until last year. I was. I like Pollyanna. If you don't know who Pollyanna is, it's a movie. And she's just like Miss Positive and can turn everything around. That's usually where I live. Until I hit that spot. God brought me through, and he's got such an amazing, I've got such an amazing testimony. And when I was seeking his face last week, and I had found this stone the night before that my friend had given me when I was in South Africa a few years ago, and it's a beautiful pink quartz stone from, they have a lot of different stones in Africa, and just many beautiful mines and rocks and things. On it, it says, Jehovah Ezel, the Lord my helper. And I picked up that stone, and I held it up. And I said, Ani Adonai, Jehovah Ezel, the Lord my God is my helper. I said, God, I can't. But you can. God, I can't, but you can. And I just began to pray. And press in, and Edie was with me, and we were praying, and we were crying out to God. And I felt something shift in the spirit. And I felt the resistance go. And I felt an opening where hope could come in. Because hope makes a way for faith to operate. And I felt the love of God come in and shake things. And the next morning, my husband and I were watching Chuck Pierce, Glory of Zion, and they talked, and the worship was just amazing. And Robert Heidler talked about the month that we're in, and it being these dire straits. And this decree came out of me. And I want to decree this decree, and then I'm going to go into some decrees that I feel like the Lord has said to share. I want to prophesy some things. Because here's what happened. At the very moment I said a huge yes to a major life shift change in ministry and where we lived, the floodgates of hell opened. And I literally felt like, where was God? But he was there, and he was with me every moment. And I almost didn't press in, but I didn't give up because of his love. So I want to encourage you. There's places right now that people are going to break through, but people are, if you agree, listen, the Lord spoke to me about a month ago, and he says, you cannot say, I can't anymore. If you say, I can't, you say it this way, I can't, but God can. I can't. In my weakness, his strength is made perfect. I can't do what he's asking me to do. I don't even want to do ministry anymore. I never actually even wanted to be in ministry. He called me. I said, yes. He saved me so radically. I was like, whatever you want, I will do because of the radical salvation. But it wasn't the path that I had pursued. I was not one of those running after, I want to be the next who's who. I want a platform ministry. I want this. I want that. I didn't want any of that. And I still don't want that stuff. I want him. And that's like tonight, that was my prayer. God, I just want you. And as this worship tonight, that's what I want. That's where we're supposed to live from. Do you know what was happening tonight? God was shifting and changing things for us because out of his presence, he moves mountains and he's still God. He's still God. So I want to decree this decree. The Lord, my helper. 1 Samuel 7:12 in the Message says, Samuel took a single rock and set it upright between Mizpah and Shen. He named it Ebenezer, rock of help, saying, this marks the place where God helped us. How about we all say tonight, let's go get a stone sometime over the next few days. Because tonight, Jesus is here and he's helping us. Ebenezer's here. The Lord our help is here tonight. He's here now. We're not waiting for him for tomorrow. He's here now. And let's take that and say, Lord, this is where you helped us. This is where. And so I decree, and I'm sorry, I meant to get it so we could have it up here, and I just didn't. I'm not always administratively ahead of the game. So I'm going to read it. How about if I read a line and you want to decree it with me?
Yes.
How about you stand up? We trust in the Lord.
We trust in the Lord.
Ani Adonai.
Ani Adonai.
Jehovah Ezer.
Jehovah Ezer.
The Lord our God.
The Lord our God.
Is our helper.
Is our helper.
We arise in faith.
We arise in faith.
He meets us.
He meets us.
When we call to him.
Hope
opens the door.
Hope opens the door.
Of unlimited blessings.
Of unlimited blessings.
Pouring out from heaven.
Pouring out from heaven.
We are aligned.
We are aligned.
With God's promises.
With God's promises.
We've said yes.
We said yes.
To his holy assignment.
To his holy assignment.
We agree with his word.
We agree with his word.
The power of agreement.
The power of agreement.
Propels his angels.
Propels his angels.
To come.
To come.
And perform.
And perform.
The voice.
The voice.
Of God's word.
Of God's word.
Of our soul.
Scattered.
As grace and glory fires. Come like a flood. That's the flood I want. Yeah. All that Jesus Christ. His blood.
Purchased.
It cannot.
Be kept from us.
Here he comes. The Lord our helper.
Jehovah Ezer.
Jehovah. presence.
In his presence.
He restores.
He restores.
By brooks of bliss.
By brooks of bliss.
He leads and refreshes.
He leads and refreshes.
We sit with him.
We sit with him.
At his banquet table.
At his banquet table.
He feeds.
Feeds.
And strengthens us.
Strengthens us.
Healing every breach.
Healing every breach.
His supernatural.
His supernatural.
Glory oil.
Glory oil.
Pours out.
Pours out.
Empowering us.
Empowering us.
To move forward.
To move forward.
Go.
Go.
And.
And.
Possess the land.
Possess the land.
His goodness.
His goodness.
And unfailing love.
Unfailing love.
Follow us every day.
Follow us every day.
As we abide in him.
As we abide in him.
Lord, we trust you.
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 Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Jehovah Ezer.
Jehovah Ezer.
The Lord our help.
The Lord our help.
To you. Thanksgiving.
Thanksgiving.
And praise.
And praise.
Glory.
Glory.
And honor.
And honor.
And wisdom.
And wisdom.
And power.
And power.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to read from Romans 9:28, the Passion Translation. You can be seated. Unless you want to stay standing for the word. But you'll be up and down, up and down. That'll probably be a lot of work. For the Lord Yahweh will act and carry out his word on the earth and waste no time to accomplish it. For the Lord Yahweh will act and carry out his word on the earth and waste no time to accomplish it. For the Lord Yahweh will act and carry out his word on the earth and waste no time to accomplish it. For the Lord Yahweh will act and carry out his word and waste no time to accomplish it. When we began to sing Yahweh, which is that prophetic flow we were in, I don't know. And I'm like, Yahweh, you are moving. See, he's moving here. You know, he's moving here. And only reason I share, my husband, I have total permission to share any details. If he would help somebody, that's what he's told me. Because we know that once things came into the light is when we were able to have breakthrough. You may be going through something, or you may have a loved one who's going through something, but God right now is wanting to show up in your life in a huge way. Not in a small way. It is harvest time. Last year, at the beginning of the year, before everything happened, the Lord gave me one of the most amazing prophetic words I've ever received from him. And then I barely got to go a few places before he took me to Israel. He had me change a trip that I had to go do ministry. And he took me to Israel in March last year to speak to me and to tell me to cancel all my ministry for the next couple of months. And I didn't know why, I just obeyed him, I did it. Because he knew what was coming. And when he took me to Israel, he took me down to the Sea of Galilee. And he had me walk through forgiveness for things that had really deeply wounded me in the last season. So he healed me right before I went through another major thing. He did. He's so good. I mean, the love that I felt as I sat in the Sea of Galilee, he said, Tracee, I want you to forgive like I forgive. And the way I forgive is I would have forgiven Judas if he'd come. But the shame and the deception and the demonic that had him so bound, he didn't come. But Peter did. And he's like, when Peter came to me, I didn't hold him in what he'd done. I forgave him completely and loved loved him, and I want you to walk like that no matter what people do to you. I want you to live a life of radical love. I want you to live a life that you let it go. And at that point, I thought I had forgiven some things, and I hadn't. And he took me through, and it was amazing. So then, when I came home, and a few weeks later, go through the shock of my life, one of them, and my heart shattered. I'm not kidding you, shattered. Donna can tell you. And I couldn't eat, and I had to make myself eat. And I was so brokenhearted. And I thought, how? And then the Lord just began to draw me close to him and reveal the Father's heart to me in such a way that he's so Father to me. He is so Father. He's such a good daddy. Amen. I couldn't pray, hardly much. Except help me, Father. And he did. My husband said to me one day, aren't you going to fight for our marriage? And I told him no. I did. I said no. I fought for 24 years. I went to counseling. I did all these things. You want this marriage, you have to fight now. And he did, which was shocking to me. It was the Lord. He met us. It was amazing what God did. So I want to read a couple of things to you. Psalm 144, 1 through 2 in the Passion Translation. This isn't what I was going to do tonight. I had this whole prophetic thing prepared. It happened in worship, and at least I was obedient to put these couple of things in here. I was leaving them on the bedside, and they weren't coming with me. Because I was like, no, that's not where we're going tonight. It's a beginning of something that I'm beginning to write because of what he's done. And it's about the Father's heart chamber, surrender to Father's help. Oh my, surrender to Father's help. There is a Father who loves his kids so much. He will meet you where you are. He will meet you right in that deepest place, in that darkest moment. And he will restore everything better than what it was before. No matter what the outcome was. I was away for 3 weeks not knowing if we were ever going to be back together. But God. But God. And it was so hard because my husband would not admit the truth at first. And it already seeing, you know, okay, so I'm going to just tell you, he did not have an affair. He got so caught up in the motorcycle scene when he was contacted by a strip club to do a photo shoot. He said yes with him and his guys. And so what I got to see one morning in my devotion time, because that's how the Lord exposed it, was that. Day was awful. It was earth-shattering. It broke my heart. But my husband didn't know there was a root. And the enemy did. And the enemy was trying to destroy us. And the yes that we had said to the next step of ministry. And the yes we were stepping out to. So the enemy looked for the place that he could find. And he also knew the other part, that is at the beginning of the year, the Lord had spoken to me that he was going to expose things and expose things from childhood too that had been kept hidden. And that I needed to take certain people off of pedestals that I had them on. And he says, get ready, baby girl. I'm about to expose some things and it's going to be very hard. And he had shared that with me at the beginning of the year. And in that one, I can't really share any details because it's not my story to tell, even though it did affect me. But, so there were already things that had happened that were pretty awful. So here's what the Father revealed. These are scriptures that have just become life for me. Psalm 144, 1 through 2 in the Passion Translation, there is only one strong, safe, and secure place for me. It's in God, alone, and I love him. He's the one who gives me strength and skill for battle. He's my shelter of love and my fortress of faith that wraps himself around me as a secure shield. I hid myself in the one who subdues my enemies before me. That's what I did. I hid myself in him. I just hid in the Father. And he would speak to me, baby girl, I love you. And I would just like, Daddy, help me. I don't know what to do. And he would just say, rest. Just rest. And he one day said, you need to get Wendy Alex's book, Visions from Heaven, Visitations to My Father's Chamber. That book was a lifeline for me. And it was about the sifting. So I want to share this. This is called Shattered Hearts. It's not done, but he showed this to me after the healing began. This was later. Shattered hearts are coming home to Abba. Weren't we singing about that tonight? See, there's someone who might be watching, and your heart's been so shattered, but I can introduce you to a Father who won't beat you, who won't abuse you, who won't use you, who won't reject you because you've made mistakes. I made many mistakes. Who is so loving, and he will put your heart back together, and it will be a beautiful mosaic. And he will give you a song to sing. He will give you a song to sing. And he will give you a joy that nothing can stop. And he will give you a laughter that will fill your heart to overflowing. Because he can heal every broken place. Shattered hearts are coming home to the Father. No longer scattered and torn apart. He is mending every broken place. He is oil of glory healing every heart. The heart that says yes, he will come to. When we let go to the wayside judgments and pain and surrender at a place and yield and kneel before him, he will give us garments of glory instead of shame. Many in the church want to see the Shekinah glory. But here's what Proverbs 15:33 says in the Passion Translation. The source of revelation knowledge is found as you fall down and surrender before the Lord. Don't expect to see Shekinah glory until the Lord sees your sincere humility. Church, we've not loved people well. The Father spoke to me and he said, you can't tell hardly anybody because this is what he said. He said, if you tell certain people, they're going to judge you, they're going to judge your husband, then they're going to pray things that are not according to my heart, and when they pray things, it's going to be worse for you than it already is. And so he said to me, these are the few people you can talk to. Now, I look back at that now and I thank him for it. But where's the safe shelter? Where's the safe shelter? Where's the family? Where's the community? See, the community I was a part of years ago, the Lord had to remove me from that community because he said I would never grow up to be the person I was called to be because they wouldn't let me. 1 minute, the fire was welcome. The next minute, I was too much fire. Stand up, sit down. Oh, I was like, what? Who do you think you are? Wait a minute, you're not prophesying. What? Like, the church is not supposed to be schizophrenic. We're supposed to be welcoming. We're supposed to be a family. We're supposed to be a safe shelter. We're supposed to be a safe harbor. So when I was going through this, we only had a few people left in our lives there, and there weren't many of them that the Father said were safe. So I had to get help somewhere else. Do you guys want to be a safe shelter for people? We're supposed to be. Don't we want to see the Shekinah glory like we did tonight? I'm telling you, we're in the glory presence of God. His glory was so thick tonight, and his glory is still here, and his glory will heal. I had to work through so much. Maybe some of you are going through things and you're like, I don't understand. Why am I going through this? Or why is my child going through this? Why is my friend going through this? Why did my church go through this? Well, I wrote this. It's called Sifted. Sifted. Who would have thought? Who would believe? God would lift his protective hand from me. Who would have thought? Who would believe? God would lift his protective hand from me. But Satan came with the writ of law. His claim to sift me like wheat from chaff. My demise, he sought. Oh, but Jesus, he prayed for me. Always the intercessor, faithful and true. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit knew this day would come. My heart and hands made ready through the word. Training in heavenly places assigned to me friends who would not be moved. Wisdom and counsel, faith in their prayers. For the Father spoke clearly to me, be careful who you speak to. Don't listen to the lies of flies. Do not fall prey to pity. Lift your gaze to me. I cried out for a Father's help. I waited until I could see clear again. Temptation tried to tear me from my place of rest. Unforgiveness tried to plant itself in my heart and mind. Anger tried to find a place to dwell. But through the power of grace and love, we sent those demons back to hell. A light of hope began to rise as my friends prayed for me. And when I couldn't see the light, love held me gently. Their faith in God caused mountains to move and obstacles to flee as shackles of pain and arrows of grief were loosed from my soul. Through Christ's work of sozo, I once again became whole.
Hallelujah.
And out of brokenness, a new beginning dawned. I heard my Father say, enough. And Jesus, it is finished. The shaking and sifting exposed Satan's lies. His traps and snares uncovered. God's love is healing and mending the gap as the sifting comes to an end. It's only the beginning of this chapter in my story, for my God will turn it all around. Hope is arising, faith is soaring. He will make it better than before, and I can say, ha, 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 ha. Hallelujah. Ha, 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 ha. Hallelujah. Ha, 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 ha. Hallelujah. Because it's all for his glory. Proverbs 17:3 says, in the same way gold and silver are refined by fire, the Lord purifies your heart by the tests and trials of life. Kintsugi. Kintsugi is a Japanese method for preparing broken ceramics. They take the broken ceramic and they use a special lacquer mixed with gold, silver, or platinum. And the philosophy behind this art technique is to recognize the history of the object and to visibly incorporate the repair into the new piece instead of disguising it. They believe that when something's been fixed with this process of gold or silver or platinum, that it's more beautiful than the original. The day the Lord gave this revelation through a friend, I was in South Africa, and the Holy Spirit came in so much power that night when I was ministering with the oil of glory. And this whole revelation about the broken messes of our lives and Him putting it back together with His oil of glory, making it so much beautiful and so much more valuable to Him than what it was before, because it's His glory. See, His blood purchased us and redeemed us, and He takes our brokenness and makes us into something more beautiful. You guys, this brokenness that I went through, I now have compassion. I received the gift of compassion after I came out of this season. I needed the gift of compassion. There's such a love for the harvest inside of me. There's such a love for those who are bound by deception. I have such a hope inside of me that if God could fix this mess, He could do anything. He redeemed me out of a mess. This God who takes the broken pieces of our lives and comes with the oil of His glory. Do you understand? I love the blood of Christ Jesus and the oil of glory. And the oil of glory is His Holy Spirit anointing oil. It is the dunamis, miraculous power of God. It is the oil of the Holy Spirit. It is the oil of the overcomers. It is the oil that is to be in our lampstand. See, maybe you've been given a report that wasn't so good, better than any medical report. Because God still heals today. He is a neodonai yohovarapha. The Lord my God is my healer. He is the one who heals every place in our life. He is the one who took every sickness when He was pierced on that cross. He took every sickness before He went to the cross when He was beaten. See, He purchased for us redemption. There is nothing that can stand against us, nothing. There is no sickness, no disease, no heartbreak, no sorrow, no grief. There is nothing. Oh, we may have to go through things. The Word tells us in Psalms that many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers us from them all. And oh, these light afflictions are just for a moment. Because you know what I said? One day when I heard the Father, when I wrote, I actually heard Him say, I was walking in this time when I was away, and I heard Father say to Satan, "Enough! Hands off her. Enough. Enough." I heard it so loud. It was like, whoa. And I can still hear the Father saying, "Enough." There's a moment, and then He intervened. Enough. Enough. The oil of glory filling every place. Psalm 3, verse 2 through 4 in the Passion Translation, "But in the depths of my heart, I truly know that You have become my shield, taking me and surrounding me with Yourself. Your glory covers me continually. You alone restore my courage as You lift my head when I bow low in shame. I have cried out to You and You answer me from Your holy presence. As You send me a Father's help." As You send us a Father's help. Jesus is here tonight. He wants to do some amazing things still. He's already done some. Let me tell you what I come out of with from this season. Courage, compassion, tenderness, fierceness, tenacity, faith, hope, more love, and a word from the Lord, a crown, a king, and a singer. A crown, a king, and a signet ring. Beginning of this year, he woke me up, and he's speaking those words over me. A crown, a king, and a signet ring. A crown, a king. And I said, yes, Lord, I'll get up. And he said, no, stay here and let me speak these words over you. A crown, a king, and a signet ring. A crown, a king, and a signet ring. And it went into my spirit, literally into me. You know, when God speaks something into you, he's speaking his life into you. A crown, a king, and a signet ring. And he kept saying it over and over. A crown, a king, and a signet ring. And when he did have me get up, and I went down to my spot where I sit with him, one of the places, and he began to have me study. He would say, look here. And he began to speak to me about what he was saying. And this is all about the authority of a believer. And this is all about what is on the other side of trials. A crown, a king, and a signet ring. A crown is a symbol of a war triumph. Hallelujah! A crown is a symbol of a war triumph. It signifies the highest level of achievement. It is an emblem of victory worn by athletes as a badge of honor and courage. Crowns are symbols of rewards of service and accomplishment. They're insignias of power and authority. Crowns are normally worn during ceremonial processions and at times of formal service such as court, judgment, or promotion. Crowns in the Bible imagery signify what the wearer has accomplished, conquered, and gained rule over. And gained rule over. Conquered, accomplished, and gained rule over. You don't always get authority over something till you've overcome it. And that crown you will lay at the feet of Jesus. And those jewels in the crown represent the wisdom, the wealth, and the resources and instruments of the crowned one's dominion. A crown, the Lord. Every battle won, we need to see it as a crown for Jesus. Every place we go through, we need to start to see that this is a place we can overcome. This is a place we can overcome, and it becomes a testimony for Jesus. When the enemy tried to have my marriage, and we had been given prophetic words, and my husband actually warred with that prophetic word. Hallelujah! Something rose up in him, and he is now the mighty man of God he's always been called to be. And oh my goodness, you want to talk about romance and love? Love isn't real unless it's willing to bleed. There's a song by, oh gosh, now I'm not going to be able to think of the group, but it's an Irish group, and I really like them. Anyways, the lines talk about love is not real unless it's willing to bleed. And I listened to that song over and over, and then there was another song on that. I listened to that song, there were three songs on that CD, and I listened to it over and over. And there was another one that, countless second chance. that line. And I had the opportunity to forgive, didn't I? The Lamb that he would receive the reward for his suffering. See, he's always going to bring us into victory. Always. 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 It's the Church of Philadelphia. Brotherly love. It's the Church of Philadelphia that receives a crown. So, in Revelation, thank you, Lord. He crowns us with loving kindness. Crowns us with loving kindness. He crowns us with his love. We've got to get back to love. We've got to get back to love. Revelation chapter 3. I don't want to read the whole thing. Verse 10. Because you've kept the word of my perseverance, I also will keep you from the hour of testing, that hour which is about to come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. I am coming quickly. Hold fast what you have so that no one will take your crown. He who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he will not go out of it from anymore. And I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem which comes down out of heaven from my God and my name. Don't let anyone take your crown. Song of Solomon. Chapter 7, verse 5 through 7. Redeeming love crowns you as royalty, guiding you into the fullness of humility and surrender. Humility and surrender. There's no way in these days for any areas of self-promotion. A few years ago, I was spending time with the Lord and getting ready to meet with people. And I heard a clock right here next to me going, dum! And there wasn't a clock there. And it sounded like a huge clock tower, maybe like what you see in London. It was very loud. And the Lord said, pick up your pen and write. And he began to speak to me about the day that was coming, that he would deal with the kingdoms of man that were being built, that were keeping his broken ones out of the church. And he was going to bring his church back to a place of love. And that many people were building these kingdoms, but God was not pleased with these kingdoms because they weren't safe shelters. And he wants his house to be a safe shelter. He wants it to be a place that no matter how someone comes in, they're loved and accepted. Jesus was not harsh with those who were bound. He was harsh with those who thought they had it all right. Redeeming love crowns you as royalty, guiding you into the fullness of humility and surrender. Even a king is held captive by your beauty. How delightful and pleasing you are. As I count all your delights, love has become the greatest. You stand in victory above the rest, stately and secure as you share with me your vineyard of love. Love has to become the greatest. 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 No one should ever feel. I said to my husband one day when we were in the beginning of the healing process, I said, don't you dare let the enemy put on you a garment of shame. I Don't you let anybody put that on you. The enemy came in when he was a child, and that whole hook of pornography and that whole hook of things and all the perversion and all the mixture in churches and all the religious people who pretend like everything's okay one day, but then they're in the back room doing something else. And kids see that. And they're not seeing reality. They're not seeing transparency. Well, you know, I told the Lord years ago, when, remember you guys, some of you were around then when we did the seats we were seated on? The vision that the Lord gave me about Goldilocks and the chairs. And he took us all into the vision of seeing what kind of seat we're seated with Christ in heavenly places. And Donna helped me. I helped everybody, didn't she? And mine was a seat of transparency. And the Lord said to me, don't you ever try to sit on any other place but transparency. It's a safe place. So that will come from love. And that will come from surrender and humility. And that comes from a place of knowing, hey, I'm not perfect. And guess what? I'm pretty sure you aren't either. And that's okay, because I don't expect you to be perfect. And I know you might disappoint me one day, and I for sure probably will you, but I don't mean to. I remember when I was teaching, and I was over this whole prophetic thing, and I said to people, don't put me on a pedestal. God will knock me off right in front of you, so that you won't put me before him. Because I don't want you to put me before him. Too many leaders try to be Jesus to people in a wrong way. We are the hands of Jesus and the eyes of Jesus. But we are not the way, the truth, and the life. He is. So a crown, a king, and a signet ring. I'm going to try to get through this little part quickly and then make a decree. I'm not looking. I don't even... I know the clock's up there somewhere. Kings rule by divine authority and supernatural grace. The power that set the king in office was presumed to be the source of all his wealth, health, wisdom, and military strategy. King also means the embodiment of a crown or a tribe. The embodiment. Yeah. The embodiment and crown of a tribe. God is our king. 1 Timothy 6:15 through 16. Yes, God will make himself visible in his own divine timing, for he is the exalted God, the only powerful one, the king over every king, and the Lord of power. He alone is the immortal God, living in the unapproachable light of divine glory. All the universe belongs to him. He is king, and we are a kingdom. People, priests and kings, we've got to understand our kingly anointing. We've got to understand that we are royalty. We're sons and daughters of a king, and he's given us all authority. He's given us a kingly anointing that when we decree a thing, it will be established. But that is because we're not decreeing what our soul wants, but we're decreeing what the Spirit of the living God says. And we're decreeing it with all his anointing and power to back it up. So of course it's going to happen, because it's what he wants. He's looking for sons and daughters who know that they're royal and that they're kings and priests to step in and say, enough. I forbid that. Our kingly authority is when we take that key of David and we say, I forbid this to happen on my watch. And then we say, and I release all of heaven. I release peace. I release hope. I release love. I release healing. So I forbid sickness to have any place in any one of us here. Now we may have to contend, but I'm telling you, every time I've contended for healing, I've seen it. Every time. If some of them take longer, I'm still contending for a healing right now. These light afflictions. But I know that God is going to do it. Here's what happens with the ring, okay? The ring is a symbol for the marriage-like covenant between the regent and his or her god. The ring is a symbol of covenant. Covenant is agreement or accord. It's a contract between two parties where the greater one forges a union that achieves a common goal that fortifies the lesser one's quality of existence. Let me put that in my layman English. So my God is this great big king. He is a kingdom filled with everything that is needed. And I can't, but he can. When I make covenant with him, when he says, I'm giving you a signet ring, when he says, I'm giving you a signet ring, a crown, a king, and a signet ring, I am giving you my strength in exchange for your weakness. I am giving you upgrades. I am enhancing your position in life that no longer are you an orphan. You're a son, you're a daughter, you are my child. A signet ring is worn by highly decorated warriors. Here's that thing again, as a sign of victory. See, all of this is about knowing. These victories give us authority, you guys. Are you operating in your authority? Are you taking authority over things? Are you seeking the Lord and saying, now you have to understand, when I said I wouldn't fight, at one point I did begin to, you know, stand up. And of course I prayed during that time, but it was not my time, you know? But as soon as the Lord gave me the things to do, I began to decree and agree. Ancient kings used signet rings to designate authority, honor, or ownership. Look at when, with Joseph, Genesis 41:42. Then Pharaoh took off his signet ring from his hand and put it on Joseph's hand and clothed him in garments of fine linen and put the gold necklace around his neck. Authority granted. This Joseph had to take off his garments. And when you look at this in Genesis, he had to wash from what he was wearing in the prison, get changed, put on new garments. Yeah. Hello? We can't wear the garments of sorrow and shame when all of that happened last year, the Lord spoke a few things to me. First of all, this is who you're talking to. You're not to talk to people. Because, you know, he said, this is why. You're not to go into self-pity. No self-pity. No self-pity. The enemy wants to put pity garments on us. He wants to put failure garments on us. That's not the garments we wear. He wants to put disease name garments on us. We don't wear those names. We don't wear those garments. We take them off. We come in. And the Lord exchanges them. Think about the story of the prodigal son. He thinks, I just am hungry. And maybe my father will let me have some of the pig's food. That's a pretty bad state, right? Oh no, what did the father do? He's waiting, he's looking. And this is how Father God is. He's waiting, he's looking. And he had a robe, and he had a ring. And he killed the fatted calf. He had a celebration and a banquet. And he welcomed him home. No matter what we walk through, that's the place that God is bringing us in. He's saying, come home, come home. But there's people then who have been in prisons, and it's been the testing time, and now you're coming into your Joseph anointing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, it's time for the Joseph anointing. And you're taking off the clothes that were on you in the prison, and you're receiving the signet ring of authority to change things. See, everything we go through, we've got to get it to the place where we let God make it something beautiful. No matter what it is. No matter what it is, we've got to let him change it. Shift and change, Lord. Shift and change. A crown, a king, and a signet ring. And just one more story on that. Thank you, Lord, and we're doing it well. Hallelujah. That's it. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So Esther, Book of Esther. And Haman had an evil plan, but God. And if you go through the story, you come to a place in Esther chapter 8. And Mordecai is now being honored for where he had been. And Mordecai is the one Haman really wanted on the gallows. And Mordecai is given the signet ring. And now Mordecai comes with a heavenly decree. And the decree that God gives spares the Jewish people from being murdered. Haman had a demonic decree. See, God wants to give you his authority. These are just symbols, you understand? A crown, a king, and a signet ring. To understand that the authority he's granting to us in this hour is the authority to decree. And our decrees dismantle the demonic decrees. What we agree with, what we speak with, is what we empower. See, I just wrote an article recently called The Image of Words. It's on my website, The Image of Words. Hello? The Image of Words. Do you know words paint pictures? And actually, our words create. And if we are filled with dunamis power of God, then all these things that we speak are actually creating. Hello? I'm like, huh? My husband and I started out the year with a negativity fast. It was really good. And we just decided we should stay on that the rest of our lives. We started out a negativity fast, and we did a 40-day devotional by Steve Backlund on decrees. Really good. And we're just seeing things shift. So I'm really happy, you know, and the warfare's, you know, still there. But it's like finding those decrees, and that decree I read, the Jehovah Ezra one, I'm going to be decreeing for 40 to 50 days because I figured I got to get it in me. You know, some people can get something and they only have to do it once. Maybe they only need to spend 15 minutes with the Lord. Me, I have to do things a few times. And I need to spend lots of time with Jesus. Or I'm off wandering, you know. I have this imagination, it has to be constantly sanctified. And it's really wonderful under the sanctifying power of God. I can't watch certain things because my mind, even to read things, even to tell me stories, I have to go, la 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 la, please don't tell me that. I can see the whole thing. I just now just saw the whole thing. Please don't tell me that. I don't want to see that. Don't even tell me that, you know. So I'm going to decree it until it really gets in there. You know what I'm saying? And I'm not ashamed to say that I need that much help from my Father. I do. I need that much help from God. I need his help every day. And that's the one thing I realized, you know, there were some things in me. There were some things in me that died when I went through what we did last year. And I didn't realize how prideful I was becoming and how self-sufficient I was in certain things. And I just am like, I need my daddy. I want to be a mature daughter. I don't want to be childish. But I am a little girl who needs his help every day. So I want to read you this really fun. I love this poem. I love this poem. And he says to read it to you. It's called Dream with God. Really love this poem. So close your eyes. Thank you, Daddy. Woo, the anointing's coming stronger. Release your glory in this house, Lord. Release your glory here. And release dreams. Holy. Holy. You see, I used to be so concerned that that I minister a certain way, and I really just, I'm just going to do what he says to do, and that's just how it will have to be. And so I'm having fun right now because he's kind of like coming over me on waves, so I'm having a hard time reading. So I'm just going to release that over you. Father, release your waves of glory over all of us here. Yeah, that's nice. Just receive. Release your waves of refreshing. Thank you, Daddy. Thank you, Daddy. Okay. So as I read this over you, if you need healing, if you've had a dream that the warfare around it's been so intense, I want you to tap into some of the promises that God has spoken here. Because he wants to do it for you. Dream with God. Dream with God. Embrace the dream. Let God come down and form this dirt as we learn to play again with him. Let his breath awaken the renaissance of our hearts. Come and play in Papa's garden. It's safe to be you here, to tell your story, B. You must remember how to play. It's not just pray and pray and pray. Oh no, it's play and delight. In unbroken communion, calm in union with our Creator. Paradise remembers little ones who dream. Discover Eden once again. It's back to the garden in the dew of the morning. Stones are rolled away. Offenses, fences fall down. Love, grace, and glory shine all around. Bright light and delight in Him found. Paradise restored. The curse is over, death has no sting. The story of hope and glory, a father's love for his little ones, not a box of rigid rules. Oh no, it's golden love, ruling hearts. I'll say that again. It's not a box of rigid rules. Oh no, it's golden love, ruling hearts. Kids, free to shine and live their story. History lines of redemptive love. Ransomed from gates of isolation. Delivered out of shame's painful flames. Burning glares of judgment no longer hold us captive. For Daddy gave us his greatest gift of love. His glorious Son, Christ Jesus. Our story is woven into his redemptive story. So storytellers, awaken. Arise with the word fully alive in you. Symbols and meanings revealing mysteries. A renaissance of hearts awakening. Unclog the wells, blow up the dam that blocked dream's story. River of creative life flowing free. Make a way out of no way. Connect to the power source. Plug in through faith, through hope, through love. Visions resurrected that glorious morn when no longer in the grave. See your story. Follow every sign. Dream of destiny. Climb over every mountain. Bravely cross every sea. Make a way through the wilderness. Out of deserts come. Journey on dream's pathway. A joyous expectation, a heart renaissance. Walking in the footsteps of radiance, living in the light of glorious brilliance. You were never made to fit in. Oh no, you were not created for mediocrity and conformity. These are not the clothes to wear. Arise and shine, put on glory life in Christ. For in the image of loving kindness, you fit with on the right side of life and the way. Don't settle for sameness, the torment of never good enough. Embrace the Renaissance journey of your heart. Live in the lines of the greatest story of all. Be found, be seen in the eyes of the King as you turn each page of your divine story, for you were created to live, written among the pages of love's greatest story. You're written. Your life is a story. Your life is woven into the pages of his story. The word he gave me at the beginning of last year was a renaissance of hearts. It was about what we've been seeing and all the creativity. It was an awakening of hearts. And he spoke about joie de vivre, which is the joy of living, and his people coming back to that joy of living and living in him. And that word has come more alive this year than it was last year, because last year I really didn't get to release it. But this year, he's been awakening it over and over and over, that we would come into this place of allowing his heart. And then there's the part of this word that he gave me, where he showed me a picture, and we were the lampstand that he was holding in his hand as he rode on his horse throughout the land, saying, "Wake up. Harvest is here. Daddy's here. Awaken. Your father's calling you home." Your story, no matter what you've been through, has value and meaning. And your story may touch one life or many. Your story is a beautiful work of art. We are the poetry of God. We are his story. What is the story you're telling? Is it one of Eeyore and "Oh, woe is me, woe is me"? Or is it one of overcoming and joy, and each day being another good day that we can have an adventure with God? No matter what yesterday was, no matter what an hour ago was, what's in the moment right now? You see, God is wanting you to rise with hope and live the dream and love people into healing and love. Listen, you guys, some people have been so shattered that if we don't love them with the Father's love, they will never know that kind of love here. We've got that inside of us. We've got an overcoming, powerful, dunamis love inside of us that heals, saves, delivers, sets free, opens blind eyes, opens deaf ears, causes the lame to dance again, resurrects dead dreams, dead bodies. We've got that kind of life. This is life. It's wrapped around love all around us. This is life. You are all around us. This is life. He's inside us. This is life. There's always hope because God is the door of hope. This is life. Ani Adonai Jehovah Hapa. Our God is love. One of the names of God is love. That's who he is. And he's in us. And if you don't know him, all you have to do is call upon the name of Jesus and call out to the Father and ask him for help, and he will lead you home. Father, I pray today that you would resurrect dreams. I pray today you would break off hope deferred. I declare that hope is arising, bodies are, that the heavens are open over our lives. And we are blessed going in and coming out. Lord, that we are your lovers and we delight to love you. And Lord, we're not going to let anything steal that love and that joy anymore. We're going to live in the light and the delight of your love, and we're going to share that
Lord, we're not going to let circumstances crush us. We're asking you for help. We're asking you to help us when we weep. I would share one thing as I'm praying. The one thing that really helped me is when I was in pain, letting me cry. Letting me cry. Not talking me out of it, hyping me up in something that I couldn't get to. Because the Word does tell us when someone's grieving, we weep. And when there's rejoicing, we rejoice. So as I was praying, I was like, I don't want to release condemnation in here. When you're in sorrow, sit with someone at the Father that you sit with and let them walk you through that, and even if it is crying with you. But when you're on the other side, let the joy come back, you guys, because the joy of the Lord is our strength. Weeping endures for a night, but joy comes in the morning. So Father, I pray that you break off seasons of grief that have lasted longer than they should have. Help defer disappointment. And I pray an anointing for miracles. Lord, you showed me that wisdom was at the hidden gate, and wisdom was here tonight. You are here, wisdom. Christ is wisdom. And that you were releasing a TNT anointing, a total nucleus transformation down to the cellular level. So I release that now in Jesus' name. Down to the cellular level. A total nucleus transformation. Father, where sorrow has lingered in the cells, that your very heavenly DNA genetics would come in and rewrite memory paths, places, Lord. Father, where there have been diagnoses or things that aren't diagnosed causing great distress, I speak the healing word of Christ Jesus, through the blood of Jesus, and I release healing power into the bodies. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Come in, Lord, in heaven. And we bless you and we thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So let God do what he desires to do in you. In Jesus' name. I'm going to be really honest, I didn't want to speak because I just wanted to stay up there and worship the Lord. And I'm pretty intoxicated with His love at the moment, so, and it's overflowing in such a powerful force, and I just felt Him whisper to me that there's divination and witchcraft that's been affecting some of you, and He wants to deal with it. Divination and witchcraft. Curses. And I take authority over that in Jesus' name. And I break the power of what was said against you to stop you. I break the power of sickness curses in Jesus' name. Through the power of the blood of Jesus. I break the assignment to try and stop the forward movement and to try to stop the harvesters in your place. Whoa. Holy, holy, holy Jesus. Holy, whoa, Jesus.
against you shall prosper. Release the power of the blood. Release the power of the blood. Release the power of the blood. Jesus. Speak to the lower back and command strength into it right now in Jesus' name. Ears open. Infections go in Jesus' name. Sinus is clear in Jesus' name. Viruses, you have no place in you, Jesus' name. Take the blood. Take the blood. In Jesus' name. Doubt. You don't have any place here. Jesus, help our unbelief. Help us, Jesus. Help us. Well, Father, I thank you that the antidote is to be in your presence. And one of the things that we haven't learned is how to come in and out. Wow, teach us, Lord, how to carry your presence everywhere we go. And flow in a way with you that you can release what we want to release. Teach us how to come in and out. And Lord, thank you for tonight. And I pray, Father, that you would take us even deeper and higher and further and better next time in Jesus' name. And Lord, I ask that you would protect my family and my precious husband and myself from any backlash from sharing our overcoming story. And that you would protect everybody here, that you would give us safe travels home. We cut out every attachment or assignment or burden or curse through the blood of Christ Jesus, and we release the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father, for angels that watch over us to give us safe passage. Thank you for angels that minister to us to give us strength. Thank you for your love and your grace in Jesus.